All right, can everybody hear me? Is everybody in this room for urology? All right, we're gonna get started here and we're gonna let some stragglers come in a little later. Are we set up with live stream? Okay, hi and welcome to day two, full day two of conference where we get to wake up a little and enjoy all the speakers today. And we are very lucky to have a doctor here who it's his first time at conference. We've had a few of those. So this is new information and we have some amazing doctors who come all the time, but to have some new, you know, fields of knowledge, especially for those with urological issues. So go ahead, Dr. Michael, please come up and do you need this out?
Good morning. Thanks for coming, everyone. I appreciate the opportunity to speak here with all of you today. And I've left plenty of time at the end, so we have time for questions and answers. I don't need to tell you folks what arthrogryposis is, but when I was preparing this talk and going through the literature, it's interesting that a lot of discussion is, of course, about what all of you know, but urologic issues don't come up very much. And I think it's important because these are pertinent very much so to our patients, our children, and I think it's a important topic. Children's National in Washington, D.C. on their website has a nice discussion and description about AMC and again lists many different issues. But what's important is what is not stated there, and that includes the urologic issues. Well, what do? We're pediatric urologists, and well, I know what I do. A lot of people don't know what we do, and it's important to understand that we are part of the healthcare team when it comes to our AMC patients. The issues that I'd like to talk about today include the role of circumcision, something very common, but why is it important for the boys with AMC? Undescended testicles, something that occurs with a fairly high frequency among our patients. And then issues related to neurogenic bladder. So we work closely with the entire healthcare team. This is not something done in isolation. Many of the kids will need multiple procedures, and we try whenever possible to coordinate what we can offer with the rest of the members of the healthcare team. We're in it for the long term. Obviously, when we first see patients, there are short-term issues to be discussing with families, but we also know that we're planning for really lifelong care. And it's important, again, that we coordinate our efforts with all the members who are participating in that child and young adult and even older adults' care over time. So let's talk for a moment about a common topic, circumcision, but some of the issues you may or may not be aware of. Well, why do we perform circumcision? Various reasons: family preference, religious reasons, risk of infection. In the first year of life with a baby boy, there's a tenfold higher incidence of urinary tract infections. After the first year, the incidence is about the same, whether the boy is circumcised or not. In the long term, there have been some discussions about whether STDs, STIs are an issue or not in the circumcised versus the uncircumcised man. What WHO has noted is with an aggressive effort, especially in countries in Africa, the incidence can be helped in terms of reduction of problems. And surprisingly, the continent overall has a much higher incidence now of circumcision than just about anywhere in the world. Some people feel it's easier to care for the circumcised boy, and we'll talk more about that in a moment. Does it make sense early on? But what we also have to think about is, will that child, as an older child, teenager, adult, be able to care for the area? Can that child or adult retract the foreskin and be able to clean the area? So all practical issues. Why should we not circumcise someone? Well, sometimes, again, family preference. There are findings that we will see in patients where they're not good candidates for the typical newborn circumcision. Sometimes the foreskin is uneven. Sometimes there can be length discrepancies where the scrotum attaches higher on the underside, and the simple, quick little circular cut that is made to do the circumcision is not a good option. A lot of fluid in the scrotum, hydrocele, which is a common finding in newborn boys, may preclude doing the circumcision, since this can cause concealment or engulfment of the area, and it's just difficult to know how much skin to take. Hypospadias. This is a condition we deal with all the time, may not be familiar to some of you, but this is where the urethral opening does not occur at the tip of the penis. And there we actually need the foreskin in reconstruction, rolling the urethral tube farther to meet the tip of the penis. So these are all issues that will preclude us from doing this. Sometimes the babies are born prematurely. That does not mean it can't be done early on. It means we may have to delay. And we can actually perform circumcisions up to about a month in the office. So if that is not possible early on, we can wait a little bit. We always are interested in seeing how families react when they're making a decision. Many parents are at odds as to whether or not to do this. So we tell families, if they're undecided, to wait and to come back within a month if they'd like to have it done and they figure that that's the right choice for their child. Or if it goes beyond a month, then we'll do this later, sometime after 6 months of age, where it can be done as an outpatient day surgery procedure. One of the nice things, too, is this can be a coordinated type of procedure. If we know the child will be having surgical procedures with other specialists, we can coordinate this and take care of that at the same time. What are the risks of circumcision? Well, not surprisingly, as with any surgery, bleeding or infection, sometimes excess skin is left because of measurement issues at the time. Sometimes too much skin is removed. Long term, there can sometimes be some scarring issues. The opening at the tip of the penis may be prone due to mechanical rubbing against diapers or clothing to narrow down or cause stenosis. And also, who performs the circumcision? Well, the care of the uncircumcised boy, interestingly enough, seems simple enough, but often is not discussed with families who opt to not circumcise their boy. It's helpful to gently push down on the foreskin, just a small amount. You don't have to be vigorous about this, but this will help the foreskin, which is normally firmly attached to the head of the penis. This will help the area slowly over time retract. And it's been estimated about 90% of boys should be able to have their foreskins retracted to some degree by about age 3. If not, there may be a role for using steroid ointment to the area to soften the foreskin, or perhaps circumcision if over time problems with inflammation or infection develop. The area under the foreskin where the skin is firmly attached to the head of the penis, as it softens and loosens, whitish material, smegma, can be seen very often. Sometimes it will ball up under the foreskin. That's normal. It's nothing to worry about. Families get worried that it's infection, but just simple washing and cleaning the area without pressing or pushing the foreskin back vigorously will take care of that problem. I think this is always interesting because I think a lot of times we assume circumcisions are done with equal frequency around the world. And interestingly enough, in North America, it's about 20 to 80%. even in the United States, there's a lot of variability. Circumcisions reached a high several years ago, but now we're sitting at about a little more than 50%. So it's not quite as frequent as it used to be. In Europe, less common. Interestingly enough, in many states now, Medicaid will not pay for circumcisions unless we can prove there's a medical indication. And that number of states are, the number of states are increasing quite a bit. One of the things I tell families, if you're considering this, find out who does your child's circumcision. Traditionally, classically, OBGYNs are often the ones, at least in the Northeast, who tend to do them. In other areas, pediatricians, family practice physicians, urologists, or nurse practitioners or PAs will perform them. And what's important is there's no question how one is trained and how often someone does this procedure determines the incidence of outcome and also how often there can be complications. What we did a few years ago at one of our hospitals, we were asked to come in and pretty much take over doing all the newborn circumcisions because there were some issues. And we worked out over time with our nursing staff, with the pediatricians and the OBs, methodology. What we do is while the babies are on the mother-baby service, they get evaluated either by us or our nurse practitioners to make sure that circumcision is safe and indicated in that child's situation. They have to be at least 24 hours post-delivery. If they're born early, we usually wait until they're at least, it would be at least what would be considered 36 weeks or older. So if they're in the NICU, it's not that they can't be done, it's just that we'll hold off doing this until they're a bit older. All babies should have vitamin K. I know there's a lot of controversy in some areas of the country about giving vitamin K. If a family does not want their child to get vitamin K, this is to prevent bleeding issues, then we'll wait. We'll wait until they're at least 6 months of age. And when we clear our patients, we realize up to 20% of them may not be good candidates for the reasons I mentioned earlier. So this seemed to be a high number, but when we looked at our data, we're doing at this one hospital 1,500 plus newborn circumcisions a year. So very quickly, we realized these numbers were actually quite accurate. We have a little protocol. We give oral Tylenol, we use LMX lidocaine ointment, we give a lidocaine injection to the base of the penis to numb the area thoroughly. The babies get a little bit of sucrose, so-called sweeties, that calms the babies. And then when we do our circumcision, there are various devices. We like to use what's called the Mogen clamp. I think after trying various devices over the years, I think if someone's been properly trained, it's one of the safest devices to use. It's also simple to use. Like anything else, when you have multiple parts to your surgical instruments, things get lost. It's easier to have the sets not be as complete as you'd like. This is a single device, and it works quite well. And it works quite well for pretty much all of the babies of various sizes. We use, in distinction to a lot of the OBs, a little dressing, which uses a hemostatic dressing, a dressing to help prevent bleeding. It's a little gauze that's impregnated, and it's wrapped around the penis with a little clear plastic, a tegaderm. It's what you've probably are familiar with, used for IVs, to cover IVs. And that makes it very easy for the families. That way, they just put Vaseline or Aquaphor to the exposed tip of the penis and take care of the babies and start bathing them 2 days after the circumcision. One of the things that's important, and we had to explain this to our colleagues, is follow-up visits. We got a lot of complaints early on. Why are we seeing babies back after a circumcision? Come on, it's just a little procedure. Well, I explained to them, it's a surgical procedure, and no matter how large or small a surgical procedure, part of the care is having follow-up. Why? Well, sometimes a little adhesion can develop. sometimes there can be some swelling. And I think if families know you're committed to the care of the child regarding this procedure, it works out quite well for everyone. So we always see the babies back about 2 to 3 weeks later. Well, let's talk about what I found surprising when I looked in the literature, and there wasn't a lot of information about this, undescended testicles. Not that undescended testicles are uncommon, but the fact that undescended testicles are quite common in the AMC population. It's one of the most common abnormalities we see in newborn and older boys. Cryptorchism or undescended testes refer to where one or both of the testicles have not followed the normal pathway of descent, where they are not located in the scrotum. Now, it's not an unusual thing to see a newborn boy with an undescended testicle. At least 3% will have these. It's even more common in baby boys that are born early. Most of them, however, by 3 to 6 months of age will descend. So by age 1 year, it's about an incidence of 1%. In one large series where they were looking at AMC patients, they actually found there was about a 21% incidence of undescended testicles in AMC boys. So it's very important. It's very easy sometimes with urologic issues to forget about them because there are so many other concerns that families have. But this is part and parcel of our evaluation. And those facilities that deal with a lot of the kids who have these issues are well aware of this. And early on, most of us try and our colleagues try to be part of the team so we can make sure these issues are not missed. Why is it important? Well, obviously fertility issues, hormonal production, and a slightly higher but real risk of malignancy if a testicle is left undescended. Testicles start off high in the abdomen. Over time, they descend. They move through the abdomen. They come out through a little ring in the upper inguinal area, proceed through the inguinal area, and then another little ring just above the scrotum, leading the pathway for testicular descent. The most common location, fortunately, is in the inguinal area when we see a boy with an undescended testicle. So we can often feel this. Sometimes the testicles are a little bit off to the side. So they're down, but they're not down in the right area. So we have to look not just in the groin area, but sometimes we have to look to the side, closer to the thigh, or even to the side of the scrotum or even under the scrotum where things kind of miss the mark in terms of pathway of descent. Sometimes the testicles are absent. Well, fortunately, there's a mechanism called compensatory hypertrophy where if a testicle is missing, the other testicle will often grow larger. And this is helpful when we examine a boy because if we feel a very large testicle on one side and we're not feeling something on the other side, I explain to families there's a good chance that that testicle may be very small or absent. And those patients do fine. Fertility data is out there now, and it's very good for boys or men who have a single testicle for whatever reason. Sometimes a testicle is underdeveloped, what term we use, kind of hypoplastic. So we will work with our endocrine colleagues to make sure there aren't any hormonal issues that may need to be addressed in terms of future issues such as going through puberty. Sometimes a testicle may not be healthy tissue, and there may be a role when we do these surgeries to bring testicles down to biopsy them, and in some cases remove them if there's a high risk of malignancy. Fortunately, that's less common, but again, this is the kind of thing that pediatric urologists look for. Why do AMC patients seem to have a higher risk? And it's interesting. Again, there's not a lot in the literature, but people have speculated. And also, the nice thing is people have collaborated, taking their patient groups from various institutions, trying to look for possible reasons. Well, The role of muscle development or less development may play a role in affecting testicular descent. In one scenario, where the genitofemoral nerve may not be well developed, that can, in some cases, lead to less ability for the testicles to descend. Some people have looked at causes as to whether or not the contractures that may occur in the lower limbs could affect descent by creating pressure on the area. These surgeries are very challenging sometimes because the anatomy may not be the same from one patient to the next. So it does, every child, every patient is individually assessed, and our approaches may vary depending on what we find on both exam and also what we find at the time of surgery. Ideally, babies should be assessed early on. Again, it's nice to know if somebody has an undescended testicle, regardless of whether they are an AMC patient or not, because the surgery is easier. Also, biopsy data suggests that normal testicular tissue is seen in the undescended testicle in the younger patients. And biopsy work that's been done all around the world by myself and all of our colleagues have pointed out that you can see degeneration of testicular tissue over time. So again, it's something important. And sometimes what happens as well is early on, a child may be noted to have descended testes, but over time with growth, the testicles may not stay in the scrotum, they may ascend. So it's a very important part of their annual examination. And I myself have followed children, and as they grow, the cord that the testicle hangs by may not grow proportionately. And that testicle that I've noted to be in the scrotum may now, a year or two later, be up in the groin area. So it's very important that this examination is part of the total exam every year. We look at the scrotum. During development, if the testicular tissue is not near the developing scrotum, the scrotum may look underdeveloped, either completely if the testicles are both undescended or on the side of the undescended testicle. So that's something that we're, of course, familiar with, but it's something I like to point out what we're doing when we examine our children. Retractile testicles are a very common thing that we see. The testicle hangs on a cord that brings the blood supply to and from the testicle. That runs through the groin area. It also has muscle fibers, and these testicles can retract upward. Many of you may have noticed, if you have a son in bathing, you might see the testicles move up and down. Well, retractile testicles can sometimes be mistaken for undescended testicles. But likewise, a borderline situation can exist, and a testicle that may be considered retractile may be more in the undescended testicle category. So when we talk with our various referring colleagues, we explain it's better to have them checked. Because again, earlier surgery is far easier than trying to bring a testicle down in an older child. If we're having trouble feeling the testicle, what do we do? Well, we can do imaging. Ultrasound has gotten so good now, we can often see a testicle by ultrasound. There is occasionally a role for an MRI study. Unfortunately, MRI still requires sedation in many cases. And if it turns out that that child's testicle is not easily palpated, you're planning on doing some type of surgical exploration anyway. So I usually don't do an MRI, because if it's not going to change what I have to do, something surgically, then I'll forego that so I can avoid a second anesthetic. Well, what do we do for our surgical approaches? Well, again, the first situation where we can make just a scrotal incision is why I like to see children early on. The testicles are often very mobile, and we can actually sometimes approach this just with a scrotal incision, even if the testicle is in the inguinal area. However, if we don't have that kind of mobility, if we can't kind of push the testicle into the scrotum at the time that we're planning our surgery, then we'll make a groin incision, we'll find the testicle, we'll free up the testicle on its cord to gain length, and then we'll make a little scrotal incision, create a little pocket, and secure the testicle within the scrotum. Laparoscopy, an excellent way for us to look for a testicle that we can't feel. We make a little incision in the umbilical area, in the belly button area, place a telescope in and look for the testicle. And then we can either approach it laparoscopically or at least know that this testicle is heading down into the groin area, and we can help plan our further surgery at the same time. Occasionally, we have to do a staged approach. Sometimes the cord that the testicle hangs on is not long enough, so we can't get the length just by loosening the cord. And we will actually put a little tie or a little clip on the main blood supply of the testicle, because fortunately, there are other blood vessels supplying the testicle lower down. And what we'll do is we'll allow those blood vessels over several months to develop more fully, and then we'll come back, cut the primary cord supply, relying on that secondary supply, and then we can easily get the testicle down into the scrotum. Fortunately, that doesn't happen very often, but again, this is something we're prepared to do. I always tell families that sometimes we're going to find a testicle that isn't healthy. So I'll tell them, while my hope is not to remove a testicle, I don't mind if it's a bit smaller, but if it's very withered, very abnormal, there's a higher risk of malignancy in those testicles, and if there's a good opposite testicle, we'll remove that tissue. And so I always prepare families for that. Usually, if I feel a good testicle on exam in the office, those almost always are adequate and good enough to be brought down. Well, I saved the sort of more complicated portion of this talk for the end. And these are our children, our young adults, who have issues with bowel and bladder problems. This is something we see commonly, but this is something, again, while it certainly is a large part of the care we provide for our AMC patients, I want to make sure all of you understand, again, part of what we try to ask our families about as we're evaluating our kids for whatever other issues they have when they're being seen in our AMC offices or clinics. It's very variable. History and physical exam is quite important, imaging studies, and then treatment. And treatment is as variable as our patients are themselves. Well, I like this slide because really it sort of gives you the schematic, but it also gives you the idea of some of the complexities and components to the problem. Neurogenic bladder, and I should also say neurogenic bowel, really are due to issues where both the brain, spinal cord, or nerves affect the function of the bladder and the bowel. So these are how we go about evaluating our children. I think realistically, we have to ask, do we expect every two-year-old to be perfectly toilet trained? And of course, the answer is no. But we get expectations sometimes where, while we'd all like things to be perfect, we have to be realistic. And all of us who are parents have been frustrated sometimes about, boy, it would be nice to get our kids out of diapers. When are they going to be dry? When are they going to have less soiling? But again, I think we have to approach it where it will fit the needs of not only the child, but the family. So what's the relationship? And again, interestingly enough, and I think it's because AMC covers so many issues, it's hard to find pure urologic data in relationship to our AMC patients. There was one review where there were 26 patients. Now, these patients were selected based on history and physical exam and careful study of their bladders. And they found that in 26 patients who were already selected to have suspected neurogenic bladder issues, 21 of the patients had urinary incontinence. And I mean, it's easy. It's easy. You just ask families, look, not a two-year-old, but maybe a 5 or 6-year-old. Is your child dry during the day? If so, great. If not, how wet are they? And I'll explain in a moment. It's important to keep a careful diary. We don't expect families to keep a detailed diary, but sometimes we really don't know. We just know that it's an issue, but we like to document how often does that child need to be changed? Is it a day or nighttime problem? So these are the questions that we ask. I think what's very important is in the 21 patients who had urinary incontinence, at least half of them had a history of urinary tract infections. So if you're not emptying your bladder, there's a much higher risk of urinary tract infection. Also important, how many of those had kidney issues? Hopefully, fortunately, it wasn't the highest percentage, but still not an insignificant amount. Now, I do realize these are small numbers, but how many more children are out there who do have issues? And again, once we know of urinary tract problems, it's very important to screen. Now, a lot of times with the imaging studies that are obtained with our kids, kidneys will be seen sort of coincidentally or incidentally. And that's important because sometimes that's how we first pick up on some problems. Urodynamic studies. When they looked at this group, 14 of the patients, 64%, had what we would term an overactive bladder, where the bladder was just squeezing too often. And that's important information because there's medication we can use for something like that. Underactive bladders, bladders that aren't contracting enough. So those bladders are not able to empty as completely. Again, important because there may be something that we can do for those kids. The important conclusion from this is symptomatic children really need to be evaluated. Well, what do we do when we look for the diagnosis of neurogenic bladder, neurogenic bowel? It starts right during the pregnancy. Renal issues, dilated kidneys, a very common thing that's seen during pregnancy. Sometimes it's just large volumes of urine made by the fetal kidneys. But it may be more an issue of something going on. Blockages, bladder emptying issues, again, alerts us. And we'll often even meet with families during pregnancy to talk about what are the potential issues, what we need to do before that family goes home from the hospital. And typically, when we know there's a urinary tract issue in during a woman's pregnancy, we will make sure we at least get an ultrasound before they leave the hospital, because that's the best time where you can identify children who may be at risk. We like to ask, what's the ambulation status of your child? Why is this important? Well, I mean, look, if someone's having trouble getting to the bathroom, that can play a part of the care of this child. We also like to understand what's the neurologic status. That's where our orthopedic neurology and neurosurgical colleagues can help us, because in the case of spine abnormalities, especially the lower spine, that can definitely affect the nerves leaving the lower spine, going to the bladder and the bowel, and can affect storage of the bladder, continence issues in terms of sphincter control. Wetting episodes, day and night. Developmentally, children often get better with their daytime issues first, where the nighttime issues may take quite a while. But it's important to distinguish the two. And it's also important, we'll get kids coming to see us with nighttime issues, but very often people forget to ask what is really going on during the daytime. Is that a child who isn't taking the time to try to empty his or her bladder at regular intervals during the daytime? So the two are always linked. And again, with direction from us, with our nurse practitioners, we ask our families to help. And to help us, it means getting a diary. taking 1 or 2 days and recording the amounts that child goes, recording not only bladder issues, but bowel habits as well. Constipation. I'm not a GI doctor. I use a very simple definition. If a child is not having at least one good, well-formed, easy-to-have bowel movement every single day, that's constipation. Now, that's something we all ideally strive for, not only our kids, but all of us. Does that always happen? Of course not. But this gives us a starting point, and that's what we need to determine. And it's very easy, especially we're so happy if our child achieves toilet training that we don't know what happens after a certain point in time. So that's something we have to keep tabs on. If the rectal area is full of a lot of hard stool pushing on that bladder, that affects how the bladder functions. And very often when we get children coming in to see us in the office, the bladder issues are why they're in. But it's interesting that many of them have bowel issues. And some of them, 20% or more, if you address the bowel issues, the bladder issues go away. So that's something we also explain to our colleagues in the emergency room when someone may come in having difficulty emptying their bladders. You don't put a catheter in right away. What you do is you make sure they're not constipated. And sometimes suppositories or enemas are the way to go to help them. So, as I mentioned, we like to get this voiding diary. The voiding diary is helpful too because it takes time. It means for a full day or two, you have to document and monitor what your child is doing. But it's an important way to see how well we're all going to work as a team. If I can get families to provide me with that information, I know they're interested. I know they're committed to working with their children. And sometimes getting that initial voiding diary is the hardest part of everything we do. Well, what do we do on our examination? Well, again, I've alluded to this before. We like to look at their neurologic status. We like to assess the lower spine. We like to look for dimpling or pitting in the area of the lower back where there may be indications of what we call a tethered cord, where there's less mobility of the lower spine, where the nerve fibers may be trapped or encased so that the stimulation to the bowel and bladder are not as adequate. And there are roles for some of these patients having what's called a tethered cord release, freeing things up so you have better nerve function. We'll get ultrasounds of the kidney and bladder, and it's always important if the child's capable of doing this, if they're old enough, to get what we call before and after voiding views. We always like to look at the kidneys and bladder with the bladder full, have them go to the bathroom, and then see how well they empty. Some kids are very quick about using the bathroom. They run and run out, and they never take time to empty. So it may be a matter of just working on a little more behavioral approaches to get them to use the restroom more often, to sit or stand there longer, go a second time to try to empty more completely. KUB, a bladder x-ray study. What do we do there? We like to see if the belly is full of stool, and that can help assess us and also follow them for their treatment. MRI CT scans to look at spinal abnormalities. We'll sometimes look for kidney damage and get scans to make sure there haven't been some silent injuries. A bladder x-ray, what's called histogram, where their bladder's filled, and we see how well the children empty. That requires placing a catheter, filling the bladder, and we see how well they do. And then, of course, we'll do blood work to assess kidney function. Urodynamics, bladder pressure studies, where we fill the bladder and we see how large the bladder capacity is and what pressures are there. Voiding cystogram, I mentioned just a moment ago. Now, we have the ability at many of our places to what's called a video urodynamics, where we do both the bladder x-ray and the pressure studies at the same time. And we have a nice setup, for example, at Shriners Hospital in Philadelphia. And that gives us real-time imaging of what the bladder is doing and what's happening while the bladder is emptying. And then we do what are called flow studies. Simply, a patient urinates in a container that's on a scale that's linked to the computer. And we can see the pattern of flow. Does that child void with a nice even pattern? Is it an interrupted pattern? And it gives us an idea of what they're able to do. And also we can see whether the pelvic floor muscles relax to allow the sphincter to open. And that's called EMG, electromyography, and that can be very helpful. So these are our goals: to make sure the bladder is of adequate size, low pressures to protect the kidneys, and can the bladders empty or will they need assistance? So I'm not going to go into great detail about this, but we use medications to help relax the bladder. We use medications to help relax the sphincter. Sometimes there's a role for actually using Botox. Yes, it's not just used for facial wrinkles. We'll inject the bladder itself to help relax the muscle. We'll inject the sphincter muscle to help it relax. There are medications we use. Ditropan is a common one, Miralax for bowel issues. And there is a role sometimes for using enemas, and they have these nice irrigation systems where it's a little easier to control the flow rate. Biofeedback we'll use with our children to help relax the pelvic floor muscles. Again, I'm not going to go into great detail about this, but there are situations where children need to be catheterized and it's difficult to gain access from below. So we'll actually use the appendix, where we'll place the appendix on its blood supply into the bladder, and we'll also create an opening in the lower abdomen or even the umbilical area so they can catheterize. So either standing or sitting, they can easily access the bladder. In a similar fashion, there's a way to take the appendix, leave it attached to the bowel, and perform what are called antegrade enemas. So a little catheter can be placed and the entire colon can be flushed to irrigate the area, and that's very effective. And we can even do both of these procedures at the same time. So what I'd like to end with is, we know there are many options we have for our children who have urologic issues. We're part of the team. We're here to help. Don't hesitate to call on any of us. We have colleagues all around the world, and I'm always happy to help families find someone if they're not in their area. So thank you very much.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Packer. Can we move questions? He's going to be around to answer them. And I know these usually take a long time, and our time is up. So if it's all right, we need to exit this room, maybe go to the right, and you can form your crowd around him there. Thank you so much.
Hello. That's definitely coming out the speakers, right? Sounds like it's coming out of here.
Yeah.
Excellent. Do we need it louder? No, that's perfect. That's not a problem at all.
Excellent. I don't know if anyone's ever called you the hero before, but you're definitely my hero now. This is my interlude. I'm just waiting if I can get it. I have this. She's gonna bring me her seat. Okay. At lunchtime, I've got to go. Okay. Does it need to be picked up for a rental shop? Come back, I'm gonna set up the prom. Once the prom starts, I'm going.
As far as do you know the mic situation? I was actually going to take one of these next door and set up a lavalier.
I would.
To Gene. Okay.
My default setting is ask Gene.
Okay. Gotcha. Otherwise, for next door, we should be pretty good to go.
They need to drop these down. Can you open them?
Yeah. That was actually set it up.
All right.
So, yeah. The receiver in here is set to 2-1, channel 2, or through 2, channel 1. And I had noticed the podium mic I had to resync this morning. Turn that one on, test. I see it's set to 2-1. I didn't hear it over here.
I didn't hear it. We didn't hear anything.
Okay, thank you. I was so scared.
Hello. Now we just need to make sure that the room. Can you still hear me out the speakers? Yay! Really loud mic with a. That works. So, yeah, we've got range.
My wife is not even here. Thank you. I'm going to kill our next speaker, bringing this presentation so damn late.
What would it be?
Son, talk. See how it goes. All right?
Yeah, I think. No. No.
Hello, hello, hello. Hello, hello, hello.
I'm trying to sort out your presentation, my darling.
Hi.
Can you hear me, Lani?
One.
Good morning. I know. This is the first time I use this mic, and I don't know how it goes. How are you?
Yeah. One, can you hear me? No? One. One. Hello? No.
Hi.
Hello? I think I pushed something. Hello? What time is it? Mari, can you go live from my phone? Is that okay? Good morning. I will cry.
Hi, my love.
Hello. Yeah. This. Can you hear me? I know. Yeah. She's. Yeah. Hi. Yes. Than every year, yeah. Good, thank you. I'm a bit crazy. Can you hear me? No, right? Can you hear in the speakers? No. Hello? No. Thank you. Uh-huh. Yeah, the long road to AMC awareness, the long road to AMC awareness, the long road to AMC awareness, talk, like presentation. Can you write presentation? Hi. how are you? I don't know if I push a button and that's why it's not functioning.
This is on. That should be on. Yeah, I hear it.
Hello? Hello? 1, 2.
That's good.
1, 2. Okay. Thank you. I got this like for $3. Hi, what? You're gonna be in one of the pictures. In two. Hello? Can you hear me? One.
So, hello. If we can make our way in, we're gonna start in about a minute. And our speaker strength is the first half of the room, better than the last half of the room, so if you can come on in.
I'm not talking up there.
Ready?
Okay, voilà. This is gonna be an interesting one. Hear me. One. Can you guys hear me?
Hey, Misha's mic's not working. She's talking.
One, two.
You just have to talk up.
I just. This off.
Hello.
I never give you anything.
My husband, everyone.
Okay, test it one more time for you.
And talk.
1, 2, yeah.
Now let's see if we'll speak, if we turn both on.
Hello. All right, let's go ahead and get everybody in here. If you're here for Misha Walker, we're gonna get started. I have the privilege today of introducing Misha. And so I asked for super embarrassing stories about her in my introduction, but people got emotional and shared heartwarming stories, like boring. So the one thing you need to know about Misha that sums up her character is that she fell in May and broke her arm. She's had 2 ibuprofen, and she only missed 1 city in a US tour. She is a trooper. She keeps going. She's what we call hashtag AMC strong. Please welcome Misha Walker.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. I'm going to be one of the speakers that don't stand up there. I like walking weirdly when I talk, and I cannot sit down. So if I get you dizzy, I'm sorry. I will just be moving. That's how I do it. Okay, there is something I want to show you.
There's nothing you can do that can't be done. Nothing you can sing that can't be sung. Nothing you can say, but you can learn how to play the game. It's easy. There's nothing you can make that can't be made. No one you can save that can't be saved. Nothing you can do, but you can learn how to be you in time. It's easy. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love. Love. Love is all you need.
Yay,
there's nothing you can know that can't be known.
Yes.
Nothing you can see that isn't shown. Nowhere you can be that isn't where you're meant to be. It's easy. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love. Love. Love is all you need. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love. Love. Love is all you need. All you need is love. All you need is love. All you need is love. Love. Love is all you need.
So, as you can tell, this is going to be a very emotional talk. Sorry if I cry. I know a lot of you will cry. This is my journey with raising arthrogryposis awareness. Until I was 28 years old, I never met anyone with arthrogryposis. I hadn't met anyone before. And I even call it arthrogryposis, right? I didn't even know the name properly. I didn't know I needed this. I didn't know I need this community. Until one day, someone did a TV show, like they portrayed my life, and a mom from Peru reached out. And she told me about this conference. So when I was 28, for the first time, I came to the AMCSI annual conference, and I didn't know that there was Awareness Day. I didn't know how, you know, different we all are. I was in shock. This is my first post about AMC awareness. This is in 2012, June 30th. When I couldn't stay for the group picture, but I thought I need to do something. So I posted this. And as you can tell, it only got like 4 likes. And one of my friends from university, actually, the only comment was from a guy that was studying medicine. And it's in Spanish, but what it means is it's a very rare disease. So I don't know what is, you know, why we should do this, but it's good. It's a good initiative. So I'm gonna dress up as a Smurf and go out. And that was it. And that got me thinking, like, if a doctor cannot know why raising awareness for a rare condition is all about, I can imagine what the, like, the random person in the street, right? This is a medical professional that doesn't want to take, you know, the responsibility that she should, that he should have. So I went out and started asking people. That was my first slide ever about arthrogryposis. And I asked a few families, why is arthrogryposis important? Arthrogryposis awareness important, I'm sorry. And a few of the families answered, and I shared that around, and I was like, okay, and my answer was to give hope, information, and family to people around the world that are fighting the same battle. So to me, that was the start of it all. I realized that that was my mission. I needed to connect people. And I thought I was never, I didn't need it, right? And I realized how much I really needed it, like how important community actually is. And I want people to find each other. And you guys are very lucky. We are all very lucky to be here. There is a lot of people that hasn't been diagnosed, and they are still around the world, like crawling in dirt, literally, and being left in, you know, the streets, in side steps, you know, because people just don't understand it. So I thought, how can I make people understand what arthrogryposis is about? Like my cousin, the one that I grew up with, didn't even know the name. When someone said, like, what is it, what happened with your cousin? She was like, I don't know. She kind of bent her elbows. And I'm like, Isa, it's much more than that. So I took it to Facebook and I said, this was my campaign in 2015, when I went like, okay, I'm gonna be an open book. I'm gonna answer a question a day. It can be anything you want to ask. And I will be brutally honest. I had to answer probably the most difficult questions of my life publicly. But that was the beginning of a huge wave that just woke up with that campaign. And the next year I thought, I need to take it beyond just words. I need people to see how day-to-day life is, and my struggles. Like to put a jacket to some people, it takes, 10 seconds, right? I had to work so hard to learn how to put my jumper. It took years, and people don't realize that. And there, I was already a pro doing it, right? So this is fast. So I did a video a day for the whole month of June in 2016. And probably this was the most difficult campaign. I know we have been traveling for thousands of miles, but my grandma was dying while I was doing these videos. And she is one of the most important people in my life. So I was there at her bedside, just waiting for her to pass. But I have such a commitment with my community that I said, like, I need to keep on going. I need to keep on doing it. And I was invited to talk at the Tulsa conference. And I talked to my grandma and said, like, I need to go. And sorry if I get emotional, this is a very important moment in my life. I decided to leave my grandma and come to conference and give that talk. And this happened. On the way back from Tulsa, my mom called me and said, you need to go back now. Like, Peranchi is dying. And I was on my way to the airport, and Robert had made the first conference, and he was so involved, and he was talking about this beautiful baby that was still in the NICU. And I said to Mike, like, we need to go and see her. Like, I know we have a plane to catch, I know my grandma is dying, but we need to go and see this baby. And this is Olivia. And this moment, in this precise moment, my grandma was dying. So as I was holding Olivia's hand, my grandma passed. And I thought, this has a meaning, right? This is the beginning of something and the end of something. But then I was like, okay, things happen for a reason. Livy is in my life, like, and Livy died. And I just couldn't understand. It was too much for me to handle. So I went and did this. Those are my tattoos, my Livy tattoos. I have them in my ankles. And I told Livy, I prayed and say, I need you to guide my journey. Let's go together, all right? Let's go together, let's raise awareness for AMC, let's make people interested in researching this rare condition that affects us all in such different ways. Livy changed my life and my journey. So next year, the following year, I asked Mike, like, are you willing to visit families around the US for a lot of miles? And he said, I will do whatever you want to do, shorty. So we decided to embark. That visit with Olivia and Robert and Michelle had such an impact in my life and their lives. So I thought, how can we impact families one-to-one? I know the conference is brilliant, but when you are in someone's home at 2 o'clock in the morning, it's different. Things come out. Things that people doesn't want to share come out. And we heal, we hug, we, I don't know, just converse on the reality that arthrogryposis is. Arthrogryposis is not simple, but it is if you live it in community. So this was the first family we visited. You all know William, he's James and Matt's son. And this was a shock because we got there and I had this mom reaching out to me saying, I need to come and visit you. And because, you know, Matt and Jean are very close with us, we asked, like, do you mind if this family comes and see us in your home? They were like, no, of course. This boy, Daniel, showed up, and apparently they had been living half an hour from each other since they were born. They are exactly the same age. The hospital knew about both of them. They were making the appointments at the same time so they could meet because they are affected in very similar ways. They never met until that day when the first handprints were
done. There you go. We're pimps in the car. All
right. So we said we need to immortalize this moment. Woo! And
awesome.
We
printed the car. Come on, William.
Next to it so I can take your picture. Look at me. Look at me. Put your head up.
So those are the two first handprints ever. People ask us how the handprints were born. That's how the handprints, where the handprints come from. And the idea of the trip was to visit families, give them support, but also tell their stories. Because we have also different stories. Like here, just here, like the first story of Maria, that she's an adopted child from Bulgaria. The Allen family is so rare that the type of AMC is named after them. They are two siblings. Catherine, you all know Catherine, she has Escobars. Ali down here, she thought that she was the only person with Escobars until last week. She was like, really? Is there more people with Escobars? And I was like, yeah, no, you need to come to conference. And this is the difference of reaching out to people at their homes. She lives in the middle of nowhere, Kansas, right? Fields in front of her, fields behind her, a really small town. That's why we go to their homes. After that first year, I was blessed to be named the AMCSI International Ambassador, which has been an honor, a blessing, and I couldn't do what I do anymore without their support. They help us financially, and they help us to reach out to more families because there is so much reach that I can have alone, and that's what community is needed, right? And what AMCSI provide, what Annie created here, this is something else. This is huge, and we are very blessed. I've traveled a lot, and there is nothing like this anywhere else in the world. Not in England, no, in Spain, in Peru, like you will think, you know, Germany is advanced. No, there's nothing like this. So we need to take it. We really need to take it, like, not for granted, right? We sometimes we take things for granted and we say, like, we deserve it. We don't deserve anything. They don't have to work for us. They want to work for us. They want to provide this. Thanks to AMCSI as well, we met Mari. Mari is one of my soulmates. And so the next year, we thought, like, we need to bring something else to the trip. Like, we need to come together. This is a community thing. This is not just Dream Walker. This is not representing only AMCSI. This is representing the AMC community. And so we traveled between, I think it was 7,000 miles together, right? Which was something else as well. Because the first year I traveled with my husband, I know my husband, I will hope so. And with Maddie was something else. It was like seeing how families reacted to him, like, and the community, like how the community sees us as different individuals. Mari and I are totally different, but still, we are completely independent. So to have two figures like this at people's homes was huge. We made a big impact, and the car started making, becoming the star of the trip. So it was like, when we get to places, now it's like, oh yeah, Misha, Mike, Maria, whatever. Where is the old lady, right? People just want the car. And this car has, well, not this car, between the three cars, we have driven more than 27,000 miles visiting families. But that doesn't count the planes that we have taken. Because we yes, drive, but there are places where we cannot go, like an island, like to England. And to find community is not just finding community within your city or your country. It's reaching out and providing and helping other communities, other countries to build what we have. So last year we reached out to England, and this is the first, like, not the first meetup, but the first time I met someone in England with AMC. And one of the things that they were saying is, like, they don't receive the treatment. Even if the treatment is free, they struggle with the treatment. There is no professionals that were willing to provide the treatment that they needed. But then we went to the symposium, and there was a lot of English people, so they are just not connecting. It's as simple as information, but who gives information? Awareness, right? We need to build bridges between countries, between families, between communities, between cities. Because if we don't do that, it doesn't matter how much we have here, we're still very alone. So when we came back from England, Tracy Shock, you know her, I think most of you know her. She said, I'm tired of you erasing the handprints of the rented cars. Like, we need to keep a car that is AMC, is like AMC, and we can keep it somewhere. So she donated her car to the cause, and now the old lady is very blue. I will show you in a minute, but that's something that people always ask, how can I help? How can I raise awareness? How, from your end, there is 1,000 ways. Yeah, that. We just need to make a big bang, apparently. But we need to first to understand where awareness, what is awareness, right? So I have divided it in four sections. Yeah, self awareness. I think self awareness. Know your body. Accept your body. Advocate for yourself, because as AMCers, we have been pushed to just go and accept and get treatments and deal with the pain and all of that. But we need to know how far we can go, because when you are my age, and one of the things that most of the adults say is like, I'm in pain, and I didn't know that it was this bad for everyone. Yes, it's bad for everyone. And self-awareness means knowing about your condition. How many people really know that much about AMC? Some people get here and they don't know that there is types of AMC, right? So how can we raise awareness outside if we don't know about ourselves? So have we done our homework? Have we learned about AMC really and how it affects us? The other one is community awareness. Like, let's get close, let's work together. Let's find your community where you are. Like, we visit so many little places where people think, oh, there is no one here. And then poof, AMCer from everywhere. It doesn't seem that rare to us anymore. There is an AMCer everywhere. Now I drive through some towns and I go like, someday I will just knock on doors and say, do you know about arthrogryposis? Just to see if I can find someone. I bet you I will find a lot of people. Like, arthrogryposis is not that rare. It's 1 in 3,000. So think, it's not that rare. There is high schools that has 3,000 people. Think of the size of your city, the amount of people there is, and make the math, do the math, and see actually how many people in your city or in your town there is with AMC. Where are they? What are we doing for them? Are you doing your B? Social awareness. Social awareness is what I think for like schools, like if your son has AMC, what are you doing to go to school and talk to the high school or the middle school and say, can I come and say, you know, have a small talk about my child with arthrogryposis and what it is? Are you reaching out to your like neighborhood and say like, my son has this, can we meet? And so we normalize the condition in our community, because once it's normal, first comes acceptance, then information, and the more people you know and tell about arthrogryposis, the more people you will reach. And then medical awareness. You don't know how many families we have crossed that now they are telling to have an abortion. And not just like have an abortion. It's like, if you don't abort, I'm not being your doctor anymore. So either you do this if you want to stay in my care. If not, you need to find a new doctor. Like, what? You don't know how many cases we have found like this. Yesterday I was talking to Kira, and she was telling me this story about how she gave me permission to share this with you. And she was saying that they suggested for her to terminate her pregnancy. And then she asked like, yeah, but how does arthrogryposis look for in the future? And they say, I don't know. We don't know. And she said, like, I'm gonna come and show you. So when the next family comes, you know how it looks. So now she takes Maeve every now and then. So people, and nurses can see what it's all about. So there is a million ways of raising awareness. And we need to understand that this is for us. Awareness is for us, for the families. It's not for the condition. That's just a bunch of difficult words. Arthrogryposis multiplex congenita. I mean, they could have come with something more beautiful, right? Like, where they come out like looking like pretzels, and then it's like, hey, there is a bunch of words. There you go, deal with it, bye, right now. This is for the families. This is for the babies, for the teens, for the adults, for everyone, for the parents, the grandparents. We are people. When we raise awareness, when we raise funds, when we connect, we're connecting with people. We're not connecting with numbers. We're connecting with families that have been really affected by this. This has been the youngest AMCer I have met. She was 13 years old when I met her. 13 days old. Sorry. We went to Argentina, and we did an arthroparticosis there. And she Googled it. She Googled arthrogryposis, and the arthroparticosis came. She was 13 days old, and the mom was 17 years old. And but she found the community within the first month. That's our goal. Our goal is that a family doesn't have to feel alone. Someone doesn't have to wait 28 years, 60 years to meet someone with AMC to get the information. Right? We are here. We are like, we are massive. Like, have you seen what we achieve every day with our bodies? What your kids achieve, like the way they move? We move mountains. We weren't supposed to move. Do you imagine if we set our minds to really taking arthrogryposis out there? Doing the pie challenges, donating, like wearing blue, telling your friends about arthrogryposis, making them learn the word. Why do we call it AMC? When you Google AMC, a bunch of yeah, right? Dead people come out, like walkers. I know we walk very similar, but it's not us, right? So. I mean, let's call it by its name, arthrogryposis, because when a family is being diagnosed, they are not being told AMC. They are being told arthrogryposis, right? So AMC, if we use AMC awareness, are we raising awareness for a group of zombies? No. Right? We are not here to advertise a Walking Dead. We're here to advertise, like to raise awareness for something very serious. So this is what we have done. 27,000 miles by car, more than 300 families visited one-to-one. That's huge. Like that doesn't seem rare anymore. Like I know more people with AMC than without AMC now. 4 countries, and there are many more to travel. This year after here, we have been traveling for about 2 months now with a broken arm and everything. And we are going to Europe after this. We're visiting 7 countries in Europe, reaching out for the organizations to start building bridges. Because if we don't work together between organizations, we're not going anywhere. Like, we need to stop thinking we are rare. So we need to start thinking as a group, as a, you know, family, rather than, okay, they're from England, they have their own, you know, group, they have to deal with themselves. No, you are from New Zealand, and yes, and you are here and representing your organization, and at some point I would love to connect and see what we can do together. And it, and people ask me, like, what can we do about arthrogryposis, like raising awareness, right? Raising awareness doesn't have, it doesn't mean traveling thousands of miles. It means like posting on the internet, getting an interview, like being in videos, like being cross-legged around the world like Mari. It's something that everyone can do. Everyone from their corners. Like Rob in a mermaid tale, right? What can you do to raise awareness? That's a question that's my question to you. Does anyone want to answer that? Abby, what can you do to raise awareness? Well, I mean, she's a little girl in the white dress. Talk about it. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And quite often, they don't even know what it looks like to live with AMCSI, telling them to get rid of the baby, and then they don't see you again, right? So, like, go back
exactly.
And show them, like, this is my baby, and they're beautiful, or beautiful, whoever. And, like, I offered the right AMCSI at the hospital, so there's that way that can be, like,
yeah.
Everybody did that in every single town and city.
Exactly.
That's all we need. I believe we need to be loud and
proud. Yes, yes. Mm-hmm, that's true. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's... Yeah. Getting them early. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It starts with a conversation. And if you see someone staring, that's a perfect moment to say, hey, you want to know something? You want to learn something? I have a very big word that you can stare at and try to learn it, right? And write it, and you go like, there you go. Uh-huh. Yeah. It's very important. Education is very important. Yes.
From birth to 7 years old, and these kids were blown away thinking about how someone moves differently. And, you know, for him, he talks differently because he was born with a neurological disorder too that delayed his speech. But, you know, just even going to a middle school and impacting like a 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, those kids stepped outside of the selfish world because we're selfish at that age. Mm-hmm. Age is normal. But looking at accepting everyone and that we're all different and we all move different, we talk different, we walk mm-hmm. different, and accepting that. And it was pretty powerful and impactful for our community to, you know, kind of not stop and stare in an odd way, but stop and look at someone in amazement. Mm-hmm. And that was probably like one of the most powerful things that I had done other than, you know, just posting on social media.
Exactly. Yeah.
Tons of teenagers that are difficult. I mean, awesome.
Yeah. So you can see there is many ways to raise awareness, from talking to your neighbor to going to universities or to your doctors or hospitals. Wow, congratulations. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So we are all at this. That she's going back to the University of UCLA to talk about her son's arthrogryposis. So that's big. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Does anyone has any questions? No questions? I love you too, Brittany. Thank you so much. Raise awareness, people. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. So we got 5 minutes if you want to just.
You want to share anything? You want to share your experience with arthrogryposis?
It affects not me.
I think we are all here. We know about arthrogryposis. We're very lucky. Arthro what, right? But yeah, just share your stories. Your stories are very powerful.
If you want, we're going to have to clear out this room in 4.5 minutes, but why don't we keep going out right outside the doors and kind of share our stories?
Yeah. You want?
Okay, let's do it.
Let's go outside. Wow.
I'm trying to let you won't let me go.
Hey, go that way.
You're gonna travel in Europe?
Always, everywhere.
Yeah, that's
great. I never stop. Oh, yeah. Okay. Come here, friend.
Maybe someday I'm gonna go with you.
You tried hard, I know.
Oh my goodness. Oof, I'm hot.
I need water.
Beautiful. Thank you.
Virtual hug.
I need to take this off.
Approaching them,
they
say the symptoms.
Yeah.
Like Lauren did that with her kid.
who's walking by with his dad.
And
he did have arthrogryposis.
And did he?
Yeah, I think this is his second conference.
Oh, wow.
One guy.
You're good.
But it's because she asked him.
Would you like?
Have
options. I have a wireless mic right here if you would like it. If not, have a mic up there on the podium. Take off.
I talk quietly and I talk fast. So I
need... And if you want to walk around,
okay.
Can.
Okay.
I will get this set up so you can move through it. Okay.
Let me get this question.
So we're going to be moving your slides back here. Don't be alarmed. We're just testing something.
You were fabulous. I heard wonderful things.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being so patient with us and sending your husband down early and loaning him to me because it was very helpful. And so wait, we're going to get to one. Did you actually need something right now?
No, I was just...
Okay, so like... So some of these aren't, so the touch screen is a better and faster way to get them to close. Okay, and she's not moving up yet. So that's all. She'll say something. So she's going to advance.
We are good.
On. Okay, so it looks like we're still cool here. Yeah, otherwise it's just, you know, I'm sure you know they're streaming, so that's why it's important if you do choose to roam around, just still use the mic even. Yeah.
Okay. All right, it's on right now?
Yeah, it's on right now.
Thank you.
Hi. I like your hair bow.
Welcome.
How are you?
here? Okay.
Yeah.
Are you ready? All right. Good morning, everybody. We're going to get started. Please join me in welcoming our speaker for this session, Shannon La Spina. She is with the Richmond Hope Therapy Center, and she's going to be presenting on the intensive therapy model in the management of arthrogryposis. Good morning. Can everybody hear me okay? We good? Okay. I'm Shannon, and I am with the Bonsecours Health System, and I'm from Richmond Hope Therapy Center. We are in the outskirts of Richmond, and I'm here to talk about the intensive therapy model. Show of hands, is anybody familiar with the intensive therapy model? Okay. So this is all new information. Excellent. Okay. So just my background, I went to physical therapy school at VCU, and I've been with Bonsecours for about 6 years, and I have a background in orthopedics, adult orthopedics before that. Our center was founded about 11 years ago by my boss, Cindy Richards. It was a private clinic that was private pay only for only intensive therapy, and we merged with Bonsecours about 6.5 years ago. So now we are the intensive model, and we also do traditional outpatient, and I'll get into the specifics of what we do. And I also worked at Sheltering Arms and at UVA doing some gait analysis. So intensive therapy, just kind of overview what it is. It is, I'll go through that, but we'll go through the benefits and we'll go through who it's for and who it's not for. Some research, we'll show you what a sample session looks like, some case studies, and then specifically how it would relate to arthrogryposis. That's an example right now of a child doing what we call flying in the cage. She's actually, I think, 14 now. That was an old picture we had. So she's right there working on some back extension and neck extension, but also having fun flying. So intensive physical therapy is a physical therapy delivered in a concentrated dose over a short period of time. The full model is 3 weeks of therapy, 5 days a week, 3 hours a day. That's the full traditional intensive therapy. We do all kinds of modified programs. We'll do 2 hours, we'll do 1 hour, and we also do multidisciplinary. So some of our children might receive 1 hour of PT, 1 hour of OT, 1 hour of speech, depending on what the child needs. Or some kids might do 2 hours PT, 1 hour OT, or any combination of those. But this is the full definition. And the typical intensive program is going to include the use of a therasuit, which I'll go through, which is a compression suit. It's a canvas suit with bungees and essentially lets us facilitate different muscle groups depending on what the child's working on, what skills. And we also use what's called the cage, which is more formally the universal exercise unit. And that is a pulley system that lets us isolate certain muscle groups to strengthen them. So we'll go through all that. So the suit therapy, which is kind of the bread and butter of the intensive model, actually started when astronauts started to go up in space, and they would come back, and because of gravity all of a sudden, they couldn't right themselves. So similar suits were used to help facilitate muscles to kind of wake up and start righting themselves against gravity. So this same thought led to the creation of what's called the Adeli suit, which is a variation of the therasuit, which is what we use, and you might also hear it called the neurosuit. And therapists in Moscow and Poland adapted the use and put this to practice with intensive therapy. So that's where it kind of came from. And so here's an example. They come in, we have all sizes in our clinic. This is one of the smaller sizes. So it's essentially a canvas suit with bungees.
And there's many different ways you can bungee it up, but the child would wear this for an hour or two, going through all the functional skills that we're working on. So intensive therapy and suit therapy has been used in Europe for about 20 years. Europede started it in 1999. And now in the States, there's 90, I think there's actually over 100 clinics in the US. We are the only one here in Virginia. There's some on the East Coast, but they are spread out. So the benefits of intensive therapy for children, the child shows measurable changes in a short period of time. We always like to tell people, if you go to the gym every day for 3 weeks, for 3 hours, you're going to show some changes. And this is essentially what our children get to do. The treatment time gives the therapist more time to properly prepare. It allows time for heat and stretching and trying different assistive devices and just having that time to prepare the child and also try different things. And it also gives that time for repetition. Learning new motor skills requires constant repetition, and so we really get that input to them for 15 days versus once a week. And so we show changes faster. So in the PT literature, what's going on here when we're doing this repetition is motor learning. And motor learning is the set of processes associated with practice or experience that leads to relatively permanent change in the capability of producing skilled action. And so in order to have true motor learning, we need repetition, which is what this model allows. We have to have specificity of training. We have to have the intensity, which is what this intensive model allows. Variability, the generalizability and flexibility across an individual environment. And this dynamic systems theory is the big theory reigning now in PT literature. And what it says is kids are going to grow and then they're going to plateau and grow and plateau. And there's many systems at play in the development of motor skills. And this is what this model plays nicely into. In addition to motor learning, you also have sensory motor, which is input to the joints, definitely through the therasuit, but also through that repetition, the joints, the ligaments, the muscles, the vestibular system, learning that movement. You'll see an example of our bungee cage, which really activates that system. And then strength training. Most strength training literature out there, especially in the neurodevelopmental population, 3 times a week is necessary to see gains. So this is what this model allows for us. So suit therapy, this is an indicated list. This is not by any means an exhaustive list. This is an example of the patients that we will see. We see a large amount of children who have genetic disorders. We see a good amount of cerebral palsy. We also have lots of children who are undiagnosed. So there's not a limit. It is just a matter of if it is appropriate for that child at that time. And contraindications, the strict contraindications are mainly for the suit. And that is where we would not put it on a child who had a large hip subluxation because of the pull of the bungees could worsen that. Any kind of severe scoliosis and fixed joint contractures. Now, as it relates to this population, we can use just the trunk part of the suit. We don't necessarily have to use the leg. So if a child has significant knee contractures, we can still use the suit on the trunk to work on core control and stability, but not necessarily need to use the lower part of the suit where we might be hurting or putting extra strain on joints. Precautions, and this is mainly just because the children need to be healthy enough to undergo 3 weeks of therapy. So any kind of heart conditions, uncontrolled seizures, hip subluxations, and we have several children who have them. It's just a matter of the level. Hydrocephalus, diabetes, high BP. And this is just contraindications that we should be aware of. So a typical program, like I said, is going to be 3 hours a day, 5 days a week for 3 weeks. And it depends on the patient. Our patients will come 1 to 2 times a year. It depends on their needs. And most of our patients do outpatient therapy either in our clinic as well in between the intensive sessions or elsewhere. We have people that come from all over to come to our site. And we can also incorporate the OT, PT, or a modified schedule. The modified schedule a lot of times is maybe the real little ones, children that are maybe 3, 2, or 1, we would do an hour. It just depends on what they can handle. Or if it's a higher level child who really doesn't need all the prep work, who doesn't need the heat and stretching, who maybe just needs some coordination work, we would maybe run them for an hour PT. So in a full session, the first part of it is going to be heating, soft tissue massage, range of motion, maybe some vestibular work, biking, ball work, anything to kind of prep the body. And then from there, we're going to go into patient's focus specific strengthening. So that's typically using our cage exercises. And if we are using the cage, we would do the same exercises probably 5 days a week for 3 weeks and progressively increase the weight. So it's a progressive resistance exercise program. And it doesn't actually have to be in the cage. Sometimes we'll do your standard physical therapy exercises. We also have an FES bike now in our clinic that we've been using, and we can also do functional strengthening with that using electrical stimulation. And then the third hour, the last part of it, is we put on the suit and we will work on whatever functional skills the child's doing. So that could be standing, walking, kneeling, sitting, crawling, whatever the actual skills, rolling, head control. So just so here's an example of the just getting ready, stretching. And here is an example of the universal exercise unit or the cage. This is not our clinic. This is a stock photo, but this is what it looks like. And there is all sorts of pulleys and bungees, and you can really create any exercise you want. And this is where we are isolating specific muscle groups for the patients. Here's another example. This is a child in the cage. Looks like she's working on probably doing what we call a walking pattern, moving her leg in a walking motion. The leg is suspended a little bit and the weight is above her. So with these cages, you can resist a motion to make it harder, or you can assist a motion. So if I'm trying to teach a child to kick their leg out to the side, I can give them weight on that side to teach them this is how we move our leg out to the side, which is a motion that's hard for a lot of children who are learning to walk. And this is what we call the spider cage or the bungee cage. So you can take the bed out of the cage and or use in between two cages, which we use. And there's a belt around the patient here, and she's suspended with four bungees. We can do eight bungees as well. And this is where the unweighting really comes in. So let's say it's a child who maybe has a neurodevelopmental disability and cannot really stand upright, or they've never felt what it is to be upright. We can give them support of eight bungees and myself behind them. And now they can stand and feel what it's like to be against gravity with support. Here we can also work on jumping, like lowering. We can work on standing on one leg, tall kneeling, half kneeling, sitting. You can do all kinds of things with that bungee support. So this is the, we call this the spider cage because you can have eight bungees. So. And then here's an example of functional work using the suit. So it looks like on the first slide there, they're working on putting some weight through that left leg using the suit and doing some weight shifting on kind of a dynamic surface there while he's reading a book and totally engaged. And then it looks like we're working on some short sitting balance there. The child in the second picture has the full suit on. The child in the first picture has just the trunk portion on of the suit. So some benefits of the suit. It gives us some stabilization and it helps us line up the body as close to normal as possible. It provides dynamic correction, corrects the gait pattern, especially if we use the full suit, gives tactile stimulation, is an extension of my hands. If I'm trying to cue a child to walk, I need to cue a lot of muscle groups and I have two hands and probably need to hold a toy at the same time. So this gives me the ability to cue all the muscle groups I want, and now I've got some hands free that I can facilitate where I want to. It influences the vestibular system, improves body awareness. So this is a very big hug. And if a child needs that deep input, this gives that. Can support or resist muscle groups, improves bone density, and provides deep proprioception. So I can bungee whatever groups I want. If a child is really extended, I can really bungee up their core to get that flexion that I want. If a child is really kind of more low tone and flexed, I can bungee up the back to get some extension. So I'm not going to use the same setup on every child. And this is just an example of some sensory integration using the suit while we're sitting on the ball. So now we've got a lot of input, working on core control, and just learning where's my middle, where should my head be, where should my body be. And that's Cindy, the one who founded the clinic. And then some vestibular input, like I said, through the suit and the ball. This is flying in the cage, similar to what that first picture was. Here she is, suspended from the top. So it's using pulleys. And we can also put a bungee across for her to hold on to. So now the child has to hold on and pull themselves forward and back. So we're working on some head extension, neck extension, working on our back muscles, but we're having a lot of fun. We can also fly, we call this flying, fly children on their back, where they're essentially just laying flat, arms straight, legs straight, but they can be suspended and they can swing all directions to get that vestibular input. And if you're a child who's not used to moving, your vestibular system is likely underdeveloped, and this is a way that we can give some of that input there. This is a warm-up that we'll do a lot, the supine swinging. So, just some more examples of functional activities. That's our little guy. He's, I think, about 12 or 13 now. Just basic therapy, working on half kneeling, and then the child on the right is wearing a different suit and working on some standing. Okay, so like a lot of PT literature, there is some literature, so there's nothing not supporting intensive therapy. It needs more literature, needs more subjects. So the caution comes from there's just not enough evidence to say strong yes, but the evidence that's out there is good. So I'm going to show you some few articles that have been published in fairly recent years. But we just need larger sample sizes. So 2002, this is our oldest article, showed intermittent intensive therapy with children with CP. And this therapy is largely geared towards children with CP, but we see all populations. There was 5 children with severe CP, and 3 out of 5 GMFM scores significantly improved and continued improvement over 6 months, and 5 out of 5 made gains over 6 months. If you're not familiar with the GMFM, it's a gross motor function measure. It is one of our main outcome measures. It's a criterion referenced outcome measure. It tests the child against themselves, and a child, typically developing 5-year-old child, should be able to do all of those skills. So in 2008, this was a chart review of 47 subjects, so more subjects. It showed significant improvements in GMFM scores compared to pre-intervention, positive effects immediately on gross motor function, and more research is needed. In 2010, we had a study in pediatric PT. This was only 2 children, so it was a very small sample size. They did show some improvements. They only tested the last 2 dimensions on the GMFM, which are standing and walking. And gait analysis was improved. So that means they had better walking speed, cadence, symmetry, joint motion, and posture. But they had a decrease in independence on the PD, which is a parent questionnaire. Unfortunately, the parents knew that this was not blinded. It was only 2 patients. And the parents filling out the PD knew what intervention was happening. But the take home here too is that they showed increase in gait analysis, increased in symmetry, and this is in cadence. This is huge for energy expenditure. So even if we're not seeing true functional gains, looking at energy expenditure, if we can get them that boost of strength and endurance, that means a lot in the functional world. So, and the most recent study, or second recent study, 2011, looked at kids in and out of the TheraSuit. They didn't find any differences between groups. However, within the suit group, the control group, they found, the experimental group, they found improvements on the GMFM-66, which is a modified version of that GMFM, the PD functional skills self-care, which is a parent questionnaire, and the caregiver assistant self-care, and the functional skills mobility. And if you're familiar with the big stoplight study, this was a pretty big CP study that came out in 2013. It was a systematic review of pretty much all therapy interventions. It rated everything for the cerebral palsy population. It rated everything green, yellow, red, very nice graphics. We were in the yellow. Suit therapy was really yellow, mainly because of lack of evidence. So just proceed with caution because there's just not enough out there, but it's not, we weren't red. So that's a good thing. And that's an excellent study to check out if you're looking for a good study. And then most recently, 2015, systematic review. There was 46 studies, but only 4 met the criteria. There was pretty stringent criteria. We did find small effect sizes on gross motor function, and we need more studies based on the ICF model. Anecdotally, I will tell you, I've been there 6 years, and I have seen some significant changes. Children learn motor skills, and it's pretty neat to see. And these gains are kept. We send all of our children home with home exercise programs, pictures of them actually doing it. Here's the 5 things I need you to work on every day. And we send a copy to the outpatient therapist and school therapist, whoever it may be. And when they come back, we kind of pick up right from there. So It's pretty neat. Okay, a few case studies. And then I'm going to get to some arthrogryposis stuff, I do promise. This is a little girl who comes to us. I think she's about 13 or 14 now. I will say, before our clinic merged with Bonsecours, we were private pay only, and we had children that were able to do about 4 or 5 intensives a year. So some of these cases you'll see, they did a lot of intensives, and that was based on availability. And this little girl, she was adopted, don't really know her birth history. We do know her mom was on substance abuse, and she was born a preemie. 3 pounds, 9 ounces, no prenatal care. She had been getting early intervention, and she had Botox to her gastrox and hamstrings. So she came to us, did a full-on intensive, and this is an example of what we did with her. All her prep work, pulley systems, we used the suit, in and out of the suit, certain things we worked on, used the bungee system, functional activities, so we did all of her exercises. And so transitional changes, this is about 4 intensives over the course of a year. So from start and sitting, she could prop tailor sitting. She really couldn't move. She was kind of in her comfort zone, didn't really want to do much. By the end of it, she was ring sitting, and she's starting to reach across the midline. And that's huge to get that trunk rotation. That's a big thing. In walking, she really couldn't dissociate her legs because of spasticity. And then she ended up moving a pacer walker with just supervision. And in hands and knees, she had difficulty holding her head up and really couldn't keep her weight over her arms. And then she went to being able to crawl on a mat. And yes, some of this could have been due to typical development, but she made some good gains. These are our DMFM scores. And again, a typical developing 5-year-old would get 100%. So we wouldn't expect her to get 100% because of her age, but she did make some good gains. So if you look at the start of session number 1, way up there at the top, 26.9 in 1 year, all the way down to session number 4 at the end, she went to 59.5. That's a big jump on the DMFM. And then her range of motion gains, again, start at IT number 1 and look down at number 4, we gained some significant gains. These are the degrees of gains, not just where she's at. So lots of double digits there, lots of degrees made, and this is just keeping her range of motion so she can maximize her functional mobility. So can you hit play? This is kind of her, right? Can't keep her head up, really can't get her weight over her arms. Struggling. The therapist is giving a whole lot of support right there. At her abdomen, core control. This is when she first started with us. And it's exhausting. She looks exhausted. Okay, you can go to the next video. Or I can do it. Let's see. There we go. And here she is. So heads up, she's by herself, starting to dissociate her legs a little bit, her weight's over her arms, nobody's helping her. Now she can move around the floor and play with her siblings. And her head's up, head control is beautiful. So, all right, and hit play. So just kind of standing at her walker, not really moving her legs much. And my coworker's doing a lot of talking there. I'm not sure what's going on. So, and then can you hit play on this? And here she is, pedaling around with her pacer, dissociating her legs very nicely, and now she's got some independence. And that's what it's about, participation, independence. And then here's an updated version. She's a lot older now. Here she is. This is, I think, a year or two ago. She comes to us now. She's on lobstering crutches. We don't really have to use the derotation straps much anymore. She's fairly independent in her lobstering crutches. She's got some turbo tips on the ends of them so that she doesn't slip and fall. But hard worker.
So she still comes to us one or two times a year for intensives, and she does outpatient here and there. Excellent. All right. Any questions on any of that so far? The stripes, the bungees. So the suit itself is like a canvas suit. And then, and I wanted to bring one and I totally forgot. They're bungees. So there's hooks all over the suit, and that's what the stripes you see, the hooks are attached to that. Yep. And so they're just elastic bungees that we use, and we can tighten or loosen them as much as we want. And we are using them to facilitate certain muscle groups. Exactly. So abdominals. Yes. I think the thought about bone density is improving weight bearing, being able to weight bear because you have more stability and improving weight bearing through that. Yep. Yes.
It was private pay before.
Yep.
And now that it's not, is insurance paying for the intensive?
Yes. Yes. So we have, most of our children have some kind of, most of our kids have a private insurance and Medicaid, and some of our children in the Virginia Birth Injury Fund. So yes, insurance covers it. I will say Bon Secours definitely is a true blessing, because we are, insurance doesn't reimburse all of it, but our families are able to do it because of Bon Secours assistance.
And Medicaid is also
paying. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yep. Now it depends on if a child only has private insurance, and our front desk is amazing at helping you through this. They'll kind of go, it depends on the insurance policy. They'll maybe go through those 30 outpatient visits that you would typically get that would kind of eat this up, and then Medicaid would kick in type thing. But yes. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason my boss kind of went with Bon Secours, went with the hospital system to open it up to more families. So, okay. All right, patient number two. This is a child who's actually sadly no longer with us, but he just was a good example of, we're not working on a lot of big functional gains, but he made some really good gains in just being able to control some extreme extensor tone. So he had rough medical history, 3 brain surgeries in the first year, trach in the first year, G-tube seizures, bilateral hip surgeries, was in early intervention, came to us at age 3. And again, he did the full intensive. Our main goal was to promote flexion. This is a child who loved to be in extension. We needed to get that physiological flexion. So we used all of our tools to make that happen. Here's him just doing prep work, being stretched. This is one of my coworkers. This is called a flexion ball in the cage. This is really good for our children who love to be in extension and we just need to help find midline. We get them literally into a curled up ball. Their hands are tucked, legs are tucked, and we'll hang here for like 15, 20 minutes. Maybe we'll do some visual tracking work with them, some swinging. But this is a really good way to just calm the body and find midline. Here's him doing some corner sitting, working on head control, working on getting some trunk righting without throwing yourself completely back. Tall kneeling. And he's in our egg swing, which is nice and cozy, promoting flexion. So everything we're doing with him is getting that flexion we want. And here's some sitting. And we made some good passive range of motion. So we got 10 degrees of knee extension in 3 weeks, which was pretty significant. Abduction, 10 degrees on one side, 18 degrees on the other, which is hips, which is legs out to the side. Increase in hip flexion and hamstrings, which is knee extension, 23 degrees on one side, 13 degrees on the left. And that's 3 weeks. So that's huge when we're looking at functional mobility. And this is what he was able to do. Able to hold his head in midline. At the end, where from before he was kind of just holding his head backwards, and made some good gains on extensor tone, and went from sitting with support to be able to prop sit on his own. So, okay, this child, I think he's again now 14, cerebral hypoplasia, and he was 8 years old when he first came to us. He had 7 years of traditional therapy, 1 to 2 times a week on another site, and he came to us. I'm not sure. He did 4 hours a day. I'm not sure the history on that. It might have just been a time thing. But he had the full intensive. We used the pulleys with him, a lot of balance activities. So because it was a cerebellum, that was affected, a lot of balance deficits. Worked on gait, used the bungee, tried to just figure out where his body is in space. So the take home here is look at, so he had, again, this was before we merged the bones. Of course, he had 5 sessions in 14 months. But he went from posterior walker, so had a full-on walker in December 2007 all the way down to January 2009. So about a year and a little more independent ambulator.
and went, lost the walker, lost the canes. Here's some sitting. That was day one. So all over balance deficits. Not that one. I don't think that one's playing. That's the one that's not playing. Okay, so here he is again. Okay, so big thing here. So I'll go back to him. So he went from independent walking, and now he comes in our clinic, and I mean, he's a full-on teenager, and he's fine. Maybe a little loss of balance here and there, but it's pretty amazing he got off his walker. So, and then this little girl is our most recent one that we did a case study on. She's had three intensives. She has cerebral palsy. She was a twin. She was a preemie. And she lives in North Carolina, and she does outpatient. She had a rhizotomy, and so she does outpatient there and then comes to us. She's done three intensives. So if you look at her initial in November 17, like her initial scores, and then the discharge scores, her most latest discharge in January. So sitting went from 46% to 78%. And then her other one is the walking, 9% to 19%. So here's a few pictures of her. So it's actually reversed. On the right is the former. So she's got an anterior walker, less, needs more support, therapist behind her. And then she got onto a posterior walker. So she's doing it by herself. She's still slow, but she's using her upper body more, which lets us be on a posterior walker, which increases her ability to access her environment. And then on the right is working on hands and knees. She needs immobilizers. Therapist is helping her hold up, and then we go over to Liz's latest tall Neil. She's holding herself up, really trying to activate that extension a little more. So, okay.
All right, nice and slow for me.
Sorry, that's loud. This is no suit. Good. Just take a look at his gait pattern here. Look at his arms. Mainly the right arm. Look at his limp. He's not putting a lot of weight on the right side. Kind of a trunk lean.
Thank you, sweetheart.
And here's the suit.
Good. That looks so good. And back the other way. Very nice. And back this way. Wow, Sam.
So when we're looking at quality of gait there, we're looking at he's got his arm swing, trunk rotation. He's not hiking up his hip as much. It just gives him that core stability. Really, without that core strength and that abdominal activation, it's very hard to have a nice, smooth gait pattern. So that's what it's letting. And then ideally, we practice that for 3 weeks, and then we have carryover out of the suit. That's the whole kind of point of it. This is an example of, and I won't go through this video, of working on speech and PT at the same time. So the physical therapist is here working on his feet, doing some foot stretching and taping, and the speech therapist is working on some oral skills and working on some verbalizations. Here's our bungee cage. That's me in the back with my little friends. This is a child with severe involved CP. Can stand in a standard, but this is just giving her a little bit of weight bearing and feeling of being upright, because she cannot without support. She's got 8 bungees, feet on the ground, AFOs on, and I'm behind her. And just working on her, activating her quads and her glutes, working on some extension there. And this is an example of OT co-treat. She's just working on some, identifying some pictures. That's our little friend there. Okay, so the meat of it, arthrogryposis. So who's appropriate in this population? This is just based on some literature I found and just some anecdotal evidence from our clinic. Status post surgery, if we have had surgery and we need to, and this is all children who are status post surgery, they're kind of put up in a higher priority in our clinic, so we can really maximize functional gains at that time. Any kind of functional decline, change in assistive device, either downgrading assistive device or upgrading. So let's say we're just going from a walker to crutches, or we are trying to transition to a different kind of walker, and then try to lower amount of bracing. So trying to go from knee ankle foot orthoses down to ankle foot orthoses, or trying to get the stability to go to a lower level. Or if you're already working on it in outpatient therapy and, you know, we really just need to get over this hump, get over this boost, that's who would be appropriate for intensive therapy. And so PT and arthrogryposis in general, what we would do in the traditional setting and our setting, would be from birth. And this is what we recommended in the literature, is monthly passive range of motion, muscle palpation, checking on motor milestones, tracking club foot alignments, and using outcome measures. These are the typical ones that are used in early intervention, the AIMS, the Bailey, PDMS, and the WFIM. Our goals for therapy in early intervention and in outpatient would be a range of motion, sensory motor, family education on positioning, stretching, and gross motor skills. And interventions typically used by physical therapy would be stretching, serial casting falls under us, foot abduction braces, serial splinting, positioning, and compensatory strategies. And then motor development, and that's going to differ by which type of arthrogryposis. So I do have a case study of a girl that comes to see us, that's her mom works with this organization. They actually live a couple hours away from our clinic, so they just come for intensives and then check-ins whenever we can. And I'll kind of go through what we did with, what we've kind of focused on with her over the past few years, and then open it up for some questions. So she's 12, and surgical history would be age 6, left humeral osteotomy, hip release, knee plate removal, age 7, right humeral osteotomy, thumb release. And this is where, and in between these surgeries is where she came to us, age 10, bilateral knee capsule releases, hamstring releases for knee contractures, and plate placement for bilateral knee growth. And so I saw her actually right after that surgery. That wasn't the first time she came to us, but I actually referred her to orthopedic, to straight PT orthopedics PT in her hometown for a while, because I knew we needed some ongoing therapy at that point. So I couldn't serve all her needs at that point, but in between she needed somebody else, and it worked beautifully. So she's been to us for intensive several times, starting in January 2017, and then in July, and then the next April, and then the most latest in January. They come for outpatient check-ins and episodic boosts. It just depends on the family schedule. So intervention examples of what we would do in our clinic. Her orthotic management, we work with a local orthotist. We going from her ground reaction AFOs, working on night knee AFOs, night splints, and then most recently we're down to SMOs. Gait and stair training with multiple assistive devices, including anterior and posterior walkers, loft stand crutches, cane, and uneven and even surfaces. We use our time for our heat and our stretching and working on our core to work on balance. We use the universal exercise unit for strengthening. She particularly worked on isolated hip extension for terminal stance, so really getting that gluteal activation to work on standing and working on that hip abduction, which is leg out to the side for mid stance. You have to have all these gluteal muscles in order to get standing stability and walking stability. We do use the TheraSuit to provide core and hip stability, working on transfer training and balance, independent standing, obstacle navigation, use of hip strategies for balance. She also has some significant visual deficits, so we're working on balance big time and posture education. So here is her range of motion. So I bolded, it's a big chart, but I bolded the most significant gain. So we're looking from January 17 to, so 2 years later, January 19. Most notably hip extension, which is the amount you can get your hip back. She went from minus 23 and minus 17. So that's lacking 20 degrees from what we call neutral, all the way to minus 4, which is in the pretty normal range. So that is the amount. If I'm looking at hip extension, how much can I stand up straight? And knee extension, so that's hamstring tightness and how much your knee can straighten out, minus 16 and minus 9, all the way essentially down to 0 right now, which is normal. So we want a nice straight knee to be able to walk without being tight and crouched. And then we're looking at functional mobility. The biggest things here are looking at standing. Initially, she could stand for 4 seconds. On our own, with close supervision, and went to be able to essentially stand on one leg for 1 second. So starting to do that, and can hold step stance on a Bosu. So she can put one leg up on kind of a wobble board and one leg down and hold her balance. And also working on close guarding with her SMOs. So her standing independence went way up. Ambulation, we went from minute assist of 1, and now she's contact guard to close supervision. So got some independence there. Braces, we went from AFOs and toe-offs. We did some ground reaction force in the beginning to get some knee extension, and then we went back down to SMOs, which I'm not sure I'm familiar with the lingo, so she's those braces only go up above her ankle. That's all she needs right now. She went from an anterior walker, and now she's just on a walking stick. Okay.
And then so, step with your other foot.
This is her. This is a progression of her.
Other foot. Don't forget that back foot.
So this was before we started working with her. This is 2013, using a posterior walker with forearm prompts, KAFOs. So that's our knee, ankle, foot orthoses. This is our first independent steps, 2014.
Before she gets you.
That's our sister behind her trying to take her out.
Keep moving. She's going to get you.
No, no.
Keep moving. She's going to knock you over. You better keep walking. Keep walking.
So 2015, so a little less. So nobody's behind her now. She's still a little slow, but nobody's behind her.
Good job.
Using a walking stick, 2016. This is our clinic, our temporary clinic while we remodeled.
Don't do it, Tay. Don't take big controlled steps.
2017, so now we're down to AFOs.
I am watching.
Yeah.
Playing some baseball.
First base is this way. Come toward first. Come on this way. Straight toward first.
2018, we're out of AFOs again, and now we are on SMOs.
Make it work.
And my favorite, participation in the community. That's always my goal. Using an elliptical, working out, off-site with a trainer. So, I know intensive is not widespread, and I know that all families cannot uproot their life for 3 weeks. So our message is, you know, to try to can't replicate the full thing, but, you know, think about increasing frequency of services or have that discussion with the therapist. If there is a change, if there's a change in assistive device or bracing or surgery or whatnot, let's increase the frequency of services to really get the child over that hump. Growth spurts, we see a big decline in growth spurts in our population. Even 3 times a week with a home program in the other days will really give a boost of strength and likely function. Team approach, we always work. When I get a child for intensive, first thing I do is going to contact the outpatient therapist or the early intervention therapist or the school therapist, whoever they're working with, to find out what are we working on, what can I help with, what equipment do we need, and how can we work together to get this child what they need right now. Sometimes it's a lot of equipment needed, and sometimes it's completely taken care of. It just depends on the family and the therapist. We coordinate well with other people, and family compliance. So it is a big, big part of it. Our families are given a home program after the end of it, very intensive, and I try to keep it brief, to keep it realistic. These are the 3 exercises I need you to do every day to maintain these gains, so that when you come back, we can pick up right where you left off versus let's start all over again. And I'm very frank with the kids about that too. And I always send a copy to the school therapist or the home therapist. So if you have a child that comes to us for intensive, if you happen to be a therapist or whatnot, we're going to give you a home program and share that information. So, and in conclusion, we do help children with developmental delays and any kind of backslides in development. And we can help them learn a new skill set at an accelerated pace. Having this option locally, which for us is locally Richmond, our families used to have to go up to Michigan and Florida to get this therapy. It minimizes family disruption, it decreases cost, improved quality of life, and more research warranted, as is most PT. So here's some references for you guys. Our website, we do free screenings at our site. So if you have a child that is could potentially benefit, one of us, usually my supervisor, will do a screening and say, yep, appropriate for intensive, or not appropriate for intensive, and just need some outpatient. It just depends on the situation. So please contact us if you're interested. Suittherapy.com is where you find the information. And I have met therapists who don't do intensive therapy, but they have a universal exercise unit, a cage, and a suit in their clinic. So it doesn't necessarily have to be just the intensive model. And europeats.org is the umbrella organization for all of this. So what questions anybody have? Yeah. Mm-hmm. It depends. You know, you have to let the body rest at some point. And, you know, to us, kind of 2 times a year is kind of a good, I mean, that's a big boost, as long as there's activity in between, whether it be outpatient therapy or if the child can do other forms of activity. So there's really no one thing that works. And some kids come once a year in the summer, and once they get into school, that's all they can do. And so it just depends on the specific goals, family specific goals, and what are we working on? And I think that the days of 4 and 5 therapy, intensive therapies, that was kind of in the past, but no, it totally depends on the child and the situation. Any other questions? I do have some brochures up here and my card, so please contact us, take a brochure. If you have any questions, I'll be here. Just let me know.
Great. Thank you, everybody. All right. So now we have lunch on our own till 2, and then we'll restart programming after that.